क्लास ओके सो द क्लास इज ऑन टोनोमेट्री विच मीन्स द आईओपी मेजरमेंट. सो द नॉर्मल आईओपी फॉर आई इज वेरीज फ्रॉम 10 टू 21 एमएम एचजी. सो टू मेजर द आईओपी वी कैन आइदर डू अ डायरेक्ट मेजरमेंट और इनडायरेक्ट मेजरमेंट. सो वॉट इज डायरेक्ट? डायरेक्ट इज वेन वी आर मेजरिंग द आईओपी डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम इन साइड द आई. So what we do, we insert a cannula in the eye. We'll see how it works. Let's see this image. So this is how a manometry works. We have inserted a cannula inside the eye and we have connected to a tube outside, which could be water or which could be mercury. And so this is the direct measurement. So this is the most accurate measurement. But the thing is, this is invasive and it is not done routinely in all the cases. So the better method or the most widely used method is your tonometry, in which we use a device to measure the IOP from outside the eye, right? So we'll see this. So this was the direct manometry, and then this was indirect. Indirect, we can have multiple ways like indentation method, applanation, non-contact, and digital. We'll see them one by one. Okay, so what are the types of tonometer? So direct and indirect. Direct, now we know it is a manometer. In indirect, we can have digital, we can have indentation, which is Schiode's, we can have applanation, which is Goldman, and then we can have non-contact tonometer. So again, this is a similar one. This I have shown to tell you the various other applanation tonometers. We'll discuss it later. We can, you know, till then you can understand that applanation tonometry can be variable force and constant force. So in variable force, the area is constant, which includes Goldman applanation, Perkins, MMT, Tonopen, pneumatic tonometer. And in constant force, the area is variable, in which you can remember McLacow. Okay, so we'll come to it later again. So now first we see how do we measure the digital tonometry. So for digital method, we use our finger pulps. So what we do, we ask the patient to look down. Okay, so focus. We ask the patient to look down. Never ask the patient to close the eye. Okay, usually when we ask the patient to look down, the patient usually closes the eye. But no, you have to... You cannot let the patient close the eye. Then we use index finger of both our hands, and one finger is kept stationary, which feels the fluctuation, and another finger is used to indent the globe. So if IOP is raised, we won't feel the fluctuation. If the IOP is normal, we'll feel the fluctuation with our index finger. So this is a very important handy method which can be used in your OPD settings. So this was the digital. Now we come to the two most important parts, applanation and indentation. So basically, what is the difference between them? So we'll try to understand from here. So what happens in indentation tonometers, we use an instrument to indent the cornea. So you see here, the shape of cornea is changed. It becomes truncated, right? But in applanation tonometry, what we do, we just flatten the cornea a little. See here, applanation is used to measure the force needed to just flatten the cornea or applanate the cornea, right? So in applanation, we keep the area constant. So the more force we require to flatten the cornea, the higher will be the IOP. Similarly, in indentation, what happens, the more you indent, you are able to indent the cornea, the more is the IOP. This is the basic difference between indentation and applanation. Okay, so now we come to indentation tonometry. So now we know that it is based on the amount of indentation which is caused by the instrument, which is the prototype is your Schiode's tonometer. Now obviously when the IOP is high, we won't be able to press it more. So higher the IOP, lesser the indentation. So this is how a Schiode's tonometer looks like. You must have seen it in the OPDs. So this is like a test block or the eye. Then there is a foot plate, then there is a handle. So it is important that you hold it from this handle only. You don't have to hold it from the plunger or this thing. You have to hold it from the handle only. Then you have the plunger, lever action, and then you have the scale here. So what happens when you put, we'll see here. So what happens when we are, so what is happening? What we have done, we hold it from the this thing, handle, and then we place the plunger on the, place the shayot on the eye. And as soon as you press that, we get a reading here. So whatever is the reading, then we have a Friedenwald chart. We correspond that reading with the Friedenwald chart. Like if the reading is 5, it usually comes to 17.3, 18.6. So it usually falls. So it will, if it is falling in between 10 to 21, this is normal. If it is, see what happens if the IOP is high, there will be less indentation. So the reading will be less than 4, less than 3. So whenever the reading is less than 4, less than 3, what we do, we add weights here and then again repeat the same procedure. So we have added the weight. Now we can indent a little more and now we'll get the reading and then we'll correspond it with your Friedenwald chart. So this is your Shayot stonometer. Now again, this is a similar one. So what are the parts of the Shayot? So this is the handle, right, for holding the instrument. This is the foot plate which rests on the cornea. Then there is a plunger. There is a plunger which moves freely within a shaft and which actually plunges over the cornea. There is a bent lever and there is a long arm. So this is how a Shayot's tonometer looks like. Now this is very handy. It's a very easy instrument. So it has advantages also and disadvantages also. Now what are the advantages? That it is inexpensive, it is simple to use, durable, requires very little maintenance, you don't need any electricity, you can do it anywhere. But what are the disadvantages? That it has many errors. It is not very accurate and it will not give you very good readings when the IOP is very high or very low. In fact, also when there is a corneal scar or if the tensions are very low, cornea is irregular, then it won't give you a good reading. This is a very important topic. How do you sterilize the tonometer? So this is important that this tonometer has to be disassembled and then it is soaked in either isopropyl alcohol or you can also use hydrogen peroxide. So this is usually asked, so it is important. And it is important to sterilize every day and to just clean with the isopropyl alcohol before you use it on patients. So now this was the indentation tonometer. Now we come to applanation. In applanation tonometry, we can have fixed area and fixed force. So in fixed area, what does that mean? We'll discuss it later. We can have Goldman and Perkins, and fixed force we can have Maklakov. And similarly, there is another chart. Yeah. So this is the variable force. So variable force means fixed area. So we can have Goldman applanation tonometer, we can have Perkins, then we can have McKay-Mark tonometer, then Tonopen, pneumatic, right? And if the fixed force in which the variable area, it is Maklakov. Okay, so what does Goldman applanation tonometer is the prototype of your applanation tonometer. Now it is based on Imbert fixed law. What does that law say? This law says that for an ideal sphere, the pressure inside the sphere can be calculated by force upon area. So the force which is coming on it and the area it is applanating. So pressure is equal to force upon area. But the thing is, this law applies only for a ideal sphere. What do you mean by ideal? That it should be dry, it should be thin-walled. But as you know, our eye is not dry, not thin-walled. So for that, we have correction factors. Correction factor for tear film and correction factor for inside, corneal resistance, scleral resistance. So it has been seen that when we applanate an area of 3.06 mm, these two forces, they neutralize each other. And then we can simply calculate the pressure inside the eyeball. So this Goldman applanation tonometer, its diameter is kept as 3.06 mm. This is very important. Okay. Now, what is this applanation? This is basically a biprism. I'll show you. So this is actually a prism. It has two prisms. Can you see? Now what happens? Now this is our cornea. So we are using two prisms. So what it divides our cornea into two parts, one upper part and one lower part. And there are two, and it has displaced them a little. Now our end point, so this is the actual end point. We have to coincide. When we'll put the prism, we'll see it different. We'll see it at some other place and we'll see it this at some other place. But we have to coincide it like this, that both the inner margins coincide with each other, and the value at which the inner margin coincides is your IOP. So let's see again. So this is a part of the eplanation tonometer. This is basically connected to a slit lamp. You all must have seen a slit lamp in OPD. So this is a biprism. This is a feeder arm, and this is how you are connecting to a slit lamp. Now see what happens, and we use what? Cobalt blue light, right? So this is placed on a slit lamp. We anesthetize the eye with your paraquine or with a local anesthetic, and then we put the prism at the surface of the eye, at the cornea, in contact with the cornea, and use the cobalt blue light. Now what happens when you are touching the cornea? You see these are the two, and you're using fluorescein stain. We'll discuss the I'm not shown the method. I'll tell you the method later. So we use fluorescein stain. So in cobalt blue light, the fluorescein stain is seen like this. So what happens? See, when there is a high intraocular pressure, we'll see the Meyers like this. They'll be apart. When there is a low pressure, they'll be like inside. So what we want to do, we want to move the slit lamp so that both the inner margins coincide. And the point at which we achieve this is your intraocular pressure. So how do we use it? The process. We use it on slit lamp, used local anesthetic, dark room hona chahiye. It has fluorescein. We always stain the tear film with fluorescein, and we used cobalt blue light. This biprism is attached, and then we start the reading by 10. We keep it at 10, and then we keep increasing it till you achieve that. So there are many, this is like the most accurate method besides phenometry. No indentation is required. It is not affected by your corneal scleral rigidity. Reading directly from the knob can be done on post-op or injured cases also. So Goldman eplanation tonometer is the gold standard of taking your tonometry. But we need a dark room, we need a slit lamp, and we need staining of the eye. And again, it can be inaccurate to very high astigmatism. So there are sources of error with eplanation tonometer also. I hope you all could understand. Okay, so now again, how do you disinfect the eplanation tonometer? We remove the tonometer from the biprism and then swab it with your isopropyl alcohol or sodium hypochlorite. This is very important. Now there are some other tonometry methods. So if you remember this, these are the different types of eplanation tonometer, which are like fixed area. So Perkins is like this. It is a handheld tonometer. Perkins is basically a handheld Goldman eplanation. It has a biprism fixed inside it, like the Goldman eplanation. There is a battery to provide the light source, and the readings are consistent and compare quite well with the Goldman eplanator. So this is kind of a portable Goldman eplanator which can be used without your slit lamp. Then similarly, if you remember, the other in the fixed area was McGee mark. Now on McGee mark principle, you use tonopane. Again, your tonopane is a very good device. It is portable. It can be used in OPD settings, and it can be used in uncooperative patients and children also. So basically, there is a 1.5 mm plate. There is a rubber sleeve which is disposable. And we measure the force required to keep the plate flush with the sleeve. And it is electronically monitored. It has a battery. It is a handheld instrument, again with a strain gauge that creates electrical signal. Right? Then we come to non-contact tonometer. So in non-contact tonometer, a puff of air. So you can come to Genic and try it. So what we do, a puff of air is created. That acts like a constant force that momentarily flattens the cornea, and the internal reference point to the movement of flattening is measured. So see this. So this is basically a non-contact tonometer. What happens? The air eplanating the cornea is going. There is a photoelectric reader, and this measures your IOP. Now, advantage, you obviously it is quick, there is no asset required, there is non-invasive. But the disadvantage is, again, in extremes of IOP, it won't be very helpful. It will just give you a rough idea of it is increasing. So it is good for screening, but not if you want the correct IOP. Now, there are newer methods like rebound tonometers, which is eye care tonometer. It again, it does not require any anesthetic. It has a magnetic tip, and it again acts like a Goldman applanation, and it measures your IOP, and it can be used by ourselves also. So the patient can use it themselves. Children may, it is very important, and opportunity to monitor. These were the new, but the most important part of your this thing is the classifications, which I told you earlier. So we'll start here. So this, now you know the difference between manometry and tonometry. Then in types of tonometry, you know the direct and indirect. So direct manometry is different, but indirect, you should know that it is digital, indentation, applanation. So we'll come here. Digital, we discussed. We know the difference between indentation and applanation. Indentation ke liye we use Shiots, which you all must have seen. The parts are very important. Then we come to applanation. So this is very important, guys. Applanation, where you can have fixed area and fixed force. In fixed area, you will use 3.06 mm. It includes Goldman and Perkins, and fixed force as Maklakoff. Then Goldman applanation tonometer, Imbert fixed law is very important. Then this diameter is very important. How to use Goldman applanation tonometry is important. Then what is the end point? This is important. And process, you should know. So that's it. I think if anybody has a question, can ask. Thank you.